Welcome to This is Marketecture. I'm Lana from AWS, and today we're talking to Jean from Ânima Educação. I hope I said that correctly.
That's correct.
Awesome. Thank you so much for coming down today.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Would you mind telling us a little bit more about your company and what you guys do?
Okay. Ânima Educação is an education company in Brazil. Our mission is to transform the country by education, offering education of high quality for a low price.
Great. So today I'm understanding we're going to be talking about your journey of moving from a monolithic application on-premises using some old database technologies to moving into the cloud and leveraging EKS and data lakes.
This is exactly what we'll be talking about.
Great. So I'm seeing that we have some mobile devices. I'm assuming this is where a student would be logging in to use the system?
Exactly. So our journey starts here. The students, they log into the application, okay? We are using Route 53 as our DNS, and then it directs the request to ERB. We are using elastic load balancing, and then it hits our cluster, okay? For deal with the latency, because our previous solutions, they are still being executed in Brazil, in a traditional data center. So you're using CloudFront to reduce latency because this whole architecture are being executed in Virginia.
Got it. So we're preloading some static content or some cached content from CloudFront, and I'm assuming there's some connections here to S3 to fetch any images.
Exactly.
So let's take an example of renewing your enrollment in classes. So we've authenticated into the system. We've got routed to the right microservice within EKS. What happens next?
Okay, so one of the microservices is a renew for the enrollment. Then the services try to load data from Elastic Cache, right? And if the data is not there, it connects to RDS in order to load that data, okay? So you're using RDS, we have something around 20 database, different databases, but for the renew, we have 3 databases.
And as you're moving through this journey of separating out different structured and non-structured content, how did you make those determinations on when to, say, use S3 or RDS?
Yeah, RDS is our relational database, so for any kind of other data like file, images, videos, logs, we are not storing this kind of data into RDS. We are using S3 or Elastic Search or any other data store.
And how many services, just out of curiosity, do you run within this cluster on EKS?
Right now, we are running something around 60 microservices, but there will be more because we are splitting the old large monolithic application into microservices, but there will be way more microservices.
Got it. So I'm assuming this generates a huge volume of data that would be fed through RDS. And I'm seeing that you're using Redshift and Glue. Is this a data lake solution here?
Yes, definitely. So previously, we have just one large database. We just needed like one ETL or just some ETL solutions, and now we have way more databases. So we are creating this data lake into the cloud, and we are using Glue to load data from RDS. The data is sent to S3, and then loaded into Redshift, okay? So the idea is to create an architecture which will be used for all our microservices. You know, most of the microservices, they have their own database.
Awesome. So here we're going to have structured and non-structured data that will be fitting into Redshift, creating a data warehouse. Are you performing any analytics with this data?
Yes, analytics and running some AI algorithms based on this data.
Got it. Awesome. Well, thank you so much for coming down today and telling us a little bit more of how you're using AWS services to redefine educational software in Brazil.
Thank you.
And thank you for watching. This is Marketecture.